Okay, I'll answer some questions that you have written up.
What is love and can it lead you in the wrong direction?
What is love and can it lead you in the wrong direction? If love means attachment, it can lead in the wrong direction. Because when you have attachment, which you call love, you are attached to somebody, you call it love, then you have certain expectations. And those expectations generally are not met, and you get disappointed. And we think, when you think this attachment is love, then you're more disappointed. When you say, I have true love for you, and then you're disappointed, it's a deeper disappointment, and that's surely the wrong way to go. The reason why love takes you to the wrong way is because you have too many expectations in love. You love somebody, you expect something in return. That you will also be loved the same way, like you love. It does not happen. And I have seen so many people coming to me and crying, I loved so and so so much, but I also felt that person loved me. Now, he or she just left me. I am totally hurt, broken. I don't know what to do. I told a story a few days back, I think, about a man who came to me and he said, why are you telling people to go to their true home? This is our true home. We are happy here. He said, I have a big house, a big mansion. I have a new car. I've got a lot of money. I have a nice time. Why should I go into the spiritual path to reach some other place? I said, you don't need to go anywhere. You just enjoy your house, your car, and your cash. Just enjoy. Your time is not for the journey that I talk of. He went away. Next week he was back crying. I am the most miserable man in the world. I am the most unhappy man in the world. I said, what happened within 1 week? He says, my wife ran away with somebody else. And she broke my heart. She broken. I said, what about the cash? Why not use some? Cash doesn't help. At least, now you have the whole house. Walk about in the house. Don't be funny. It's not a joke. Hey, what about the new car? I don't feel like driving it. Why not? She took it away. What a life. That is why when you are calling your attachments as love, you go the wrong way. And what's the difference really between real, pure love and an attachment which you call love? The difference simply is, when you say, I love you, examine where are you saying it from. I love you. The I is more important than you. That's what the implication is. That I know myself, I'm doing something, almost like a favor. I am giving you something, love you. Now, your turn. It's a business deal. That's not love. When you really fall in love, and everybody does, you forget the I, and the mind is occupied with the beloved. You, yes, in my mind, you. That's what love is. And when you bring it back, mind begins to think again. Mind interferes immediately. When you have a spiritual experience of love with anybody, the mind interferes. Can you be sure? Are you certain that this was love? Simple little spanner thrown in by the mind. Love goes away. And our judgment and all that comes back. As I said earlier, pure love is giving, not taking. Accepting, not expecting. So pure love is not common, it's rare. And yet we all have it, it's become rare because we live on the advice, on the dialogue of our mind, our thoughts. That kills away the love. That is why when you see perfect living masters, like I saw Baba Savan saying, their love is completely non-judgmental. They are completely with you when they are talking to you. You don't notice any I in them. It's all you. And that's very pure love. There is no judgment. They don't say, be a good person, then I will love you. They don't say, what is your karma? Are you in good shape? They don't judge on any of these things. Once they pick up a soul, based upon the soul destiny to go back to the true home, they love that person, love that being forever, for eternity. It never ends. Love of a perfect living master has no ending at all. They love you if you love them. They love you if you don't love them. They love you if you hate them. And they love you if you kill them. That's the quality of a perfect living master. That love is very powerful, so strong. So that is the love that never goes the wrong way.
Sometimes we hear that we are here in this life to learn something. If the mind is a computer and the mind cannot take us home, what's the point of teaching a computer anything? Are we really supposed to be learning something?
Sometimes we hear that we are here in this life to learn something. If the mind is a computer and the mind cannot take us home, what's the point of teaching a computer anything? Are we really supposed to be learning something? So long as we have a mind, we want to learn. Period. So long as we have mind, mind searches for something. Mind wants to find something. Always. Mind generates thoughts 24/7. And if you look back on your thoughts, or even sit in meditation and watch your thoughts, you will find how much mind wants to know more about this, that. Mind is very interested in learning. Not learning higher education or something. Learning about the neighbor, learning about somebody else. You give a scandalous story, learn everything your mind wants to learn. At one time in my career, I was on a big job. And my orders I gave in this government job trickled down to various levels. And ultimately, they reached the really cutting edge point, sometime taking a month. I tried it. Very urgent. Move the file fast. Still takes time. Many days for the person who is actually to act upon that order, to get the order. If I tell a gossip and a scandalous story, next day everybody knows. That's called the grapevine. The grapevine travels so fast, everybody wants to know. There was two women talking. One said, you know, I found out about that affair. She said, why didn't you tell me? She said, I didn't know it was a secret. That means only secrets have to be shared. Our mind is constantly learning something, wants to learn something. Therefore, it's the built-in want to learn that we teach the mind. There's no other reason. The mind is like a computer. Computers have to learn how to use their language. Now they are making new computers that teach other computers what they want to learn. So learning is an essential thing in mind, which is a computer, and the computers we handle. New computers are coming up. Maybe in the 10 years you will have them, which will be called quantum computers. The quantum computers will say, we'll decide what we have to print, because they will not use digits, no zero and one. They will use qubits. And what are qubits? Qubit is, I can either be zero or one, I won't tell you. That's what a qubit is. It's just a discovery in physics that a particle of light called photon, is it a wave or is it a particle? This is a very old stuff going on, that whether a photon or a beam of light that we send, is it a series of particles or a series of waves? And we find if we make it go through a double split cardboard on the way, if it is a wave, it goes and makes wave patterns. And if you observe it or measure it, it becomes a particle. It's now a very big exercise. Human observation is making energy or a wave into a particle. Maybe physics will one day say, all of you who are particles made up of molecules are nothing more your own observation, which we have been saying in spirituality for several thousand years, that our own observation through sense perceptions is generating the experience. Science is coming to it now. So that is why the new computers, when you want to put something, you'll say, let me see. And it can make ones into zero, zeros into one, and change the whole context. They want to train it even more now. Computers will have to learn a lot more. So when computers have to learn, certainly our mind also wants to learn. When perfectly masters come, they don't come to teach anything. They have to become teachers for the sake of our minds. What do they come for? They come to help, let us have an experience of true love that alone will pull us. And it may sink into us gradually. It affects us straight away. It's in fact something is happening. And the mind is raising walls, mind is raising obstacles, mind is raising doubts, but there's something that is happening keeps on growing. Ultimately, it defeats even the mind's objections and mind's doubts and fears. That's the kind of love that comes. Learning is different. For that love, you don't need any learning. Nobody can learn love. It's not something to learn. We all have it. It's the basic essence of our consciousness. It is our totality. Love is coming from there. So that is why the teaching is only for the sake of keeping the mind busy while we slip away on the path of love and go to our true home. Perfectly, we masters become teachers to keep our mind busy. All the stuff about meditation, follow this diet, follow these rules, regulations, which appeal to our mind. Yeah, that's the way I know what to do now. That's what they taught for, to keep the mind busy. While mind is busy with these things, they quietly, with their love, pull us away. Sometimes we don't even notice, till much later. And because this life is created with the DVD, which now we call karma, it's all based upon cause and effect. So therefore, we have obligations, responsibilities in our life. They're created by karma. We have to go through them. If a perfect living master comes and finds there's a soul ready to go to the true home, and that soul will feel the love of that master, will the soul travel higher? No, soul has to fulfill the obligations and responsibilities with the mind. So therefore, the soul attached to the mind is busy. And what are the masters doing in the meanwhile? They're increasing our intensity of love. We miss them more and more. We want to be with them more and more. And therefore, that's happening internally. We are making inner spiritual progress. And we are wearing blinders. We can't see what's happening inside. So we can fulfill our obligations and responsibilities outside and clear the debt of karma that we owe. It's a simple thing. That's how perfect living masters observe. So that is why the teaching to the mind is not to go to a spiritual journey. It's just to keep the mind busy. love will take you to the spiritual journey.
When I start to advance spiritually, everything externally seems to go to hell in a handbasket. Why is that? Is there a way to counterbalance the effect?
When I start to advance spiritually, everything externally seems to go to hell in a handbasket. Why is that? I congratulate the person who wrote it. Many people tell me, the day we were initiated, we had so many strange things happening. We had accidents, we had illness, we had problems, more problems cropped up. My mind was going crazy. We should be calm and nice after initiation. Why are we getting through this? Then I have to explain to them that there is a thing called acceleration of karma. People say, we want to go back in this life. We want to be in list A. Well, I asked my master, Master, this person is in list B. Turn will come in the third life from now. This person wants to go in this life. Oh, let's look at the karma that has to be paid up in three lives. Okay, let's help. This person is keen. Let's help that person go home. Karma of two next lives pushed into this life in a shorter time and all that stuff going on. And she said, what has happened? Well, you asked for speed. You got it? So that is why those who are very keen to go back home, take me at once. I do get the information. We want to go home ASAP. So I say, okay, then be ready to pay off your debt faster. If you want to not have all the problems of life, stretch it out into a few more lives. Both are possible. Dilution is also possible. You can dilute your karma. Perfectly, we master do that. Somebody cannot suffer the karma so heavy from the past. Almost unbearable, they make it bearable. And sometime when they make it bearable, they stretch it out over time and can go into the next life also. And name is shifted from list A to list B. Anything can be done. So that is why these things happen only in the case of those who, as he says, want to advance in spirituality.
Dear Ishwar, I have a question about flying. Is it possible to fly without meditating?
I have a question about flying. Is it possible to fly without meditating? Sure, buy a ticket on the airline. Not a big deal. And if you don't want to fly in an aeroplane, want to fly with this body, think of flying, go to sleep, you'll dream you're flying. So flying can take place in many ways. Imaginative flying you can do right now if you want. But in meditation, the same imaginative flights that you can do with your imagination now become the real flight in meditation. That is why you get a real experience, and also you can go much further in the flight in meditation than you can go by flying any other means here.
All the perfect masters say, don't worry. How can one stop worrying so much?
All the perfect masters say, don't worry. Even others say, don't worry, besides perfect masters. How can one stop worrying so much? If you stop expecting things, you'll stop worrying. Worry is always something that we are projecting in our mind in the future. We are saying, this happened, worse can happen, worried about it. There is a very big difference between worrying and between concerned with something. When you are concerned how to handle a situation, which could be worrisome, but you have to handle it with your strength, handle it, cope with it as best as you can, but not worry. When people worry, they're not worrying about the problem in hand. They're worrying about some possible things that may happen. Once I held a seminar many years ago, maybe 30, 50 years ago, asking people, what do they worry about? Write down your future worries, what you're worried about. And they wrote down on a piece of paper 10 things they are most worried about. Mostly worrying about money, worrying about old age, worrying about death, worrying about children, worrying about what will happen to so and so. All these lists were there. And then I said, next year, leave that copies with me and I'll read them out next year. Next year, read them. None of those worries came true. What they were worried about, this may happen, never happened. So supposing out of 100 worries, one does turn up, that's what you're worried about, you have been worrying 99 times for nothing. You're over-worrying. You're worrying for something that will never happen. Most of the time, when we worry about something, it never happens. You can check back into your own life. How you worried about this could happen, that will never happen. And what happened, you are not worried about. Because you didn't know it was going to happen. So that is why worry doesn't solve any problem. I went to a church in Rochester, John's, I think some named after St. John. And then I was entering the church, there was a sign outside. Worry, it said, worry is a prayer for failure. You want to fail, worry. It's a religious message in a church. Worry does not solve any problem. Worry only creates more problems. So if we become conscious of this, we should be concerned about how to tackle what is in front of us. There was a white bearded man named, he looked so much like Master. And he was a teacher also. I heard him speak, I was very impressed. For two things. One, I liked his beard, white beard. And second, what he taught us about not worrying. He said, we worry about problem, it should not be like that. So he said, when a problem comes into your life, first greet it, welcome problem, then meet it, and then beat it. 3-point formula. Problem should be dealt like this. Greet it, meet it, and beat it. And he explained that if you don't solve the problem by your strength and best way of coping with it, it will remain a worry forever. If you deal with it, it's over. Sometimes you may get the results you expect, sometimes you won't. But the results you get will be the results anyway. Therefore, worry has no place. Be strong. Similarly, about fear. We are afraid of things which will never happen. Most of the things we are afraid of, this might happen, don't happen. So there's no sense of fearing so much. But fear and doubt will come to us so long as we identify ourselves with our mind. When we realize we are not the mind and can observe the mind working and separate ourselves, which is part of meditation technique, to separate ourselves from the mind. When you separate yourself from the mind, fear disappears forever. You become fearless. Doubt disappears forever. That is why when you go to see Perfect Living Master, like I would see Baba Savan Singh, he was fearless all the time. Fearless, certain. In the talks that Perfect Living Master gives, there are no such words as maybe, perhaps. Those are the words in the professor's language when they teach. In intellectual language, there is always a maybe or a perhaps. Not in the language of the Perfect Living Master. Because what they are saying for what they are immediately experiencing at that time. As I said in the morning session, when you reach that state of totality, you are automatically knowing everything of every level. Therefore, it's a beautiful experience. You're not living at one reality at a time. You're living in all realities and all illusions. They're all the same. That's what you find out. The realities have been created like that to be real. So when you have that state, fearlessness comes natural. No worry takes place. So that is why just become strong to deal with the problems in hand and don't spend too much time speculating on what might happen, nor do I spend too much time in what has already happened. Imagine most of us are spending so much time in looking back what happened. Oh, I could have done that better. Oh, I shouldn't have done that. That's a very silly way of living. To be living in the past, do you know what you will remember the most? Very few good things. You remember mostly negative things of the past. You did something wrong. Okay, you did it. And you felt it was wrong. Do you have to feel that it was wrong all your life? Isn't it enough to feel wrong? Say sorry, forgive yourself, forgive others, and move on. No, we carry that guilt throughout. And guilt is a very big detriment, very big obstacle to good meditation. Because when we want to meditate right here in the present, the old thoughts come. Guilt is a very heavy thought that we carry all the time. So there should be no place for guilt. Guilt can only go away by an affirmation of forgiveness. Oh, I did wrong to my mother and she now died. I can't even ask for forgiveness. Yes, you can. Forgive her in absentia. She may be dead for you, but she may be able to hear your forgiveness. And so many times we condemn ourselves because we did not forgive, we didn't do the right thing, and we carry this stuff all our life. No, forgive yourself also. Forgiveness is a wonderful remedy for so much of our life's illness. Forgive yourself, forgive all others. All others, forgive them. And forgive yourself. See how light you feel and how good meditation becomes with that.
If your master is within you, why doesn't everyone have a unique master? Why can't you only be my master?
If your master is within you, why doesn't everyone here have a unique master? Why can't you only be my master? Master is a human being, ordinary human being, just like us, born like us, dies like us, falls sick like us, eats food like us, goes to hospital like us, has children like us, has responsibilities. No difference at all between the life of a perfect living master and another human being, including his disciples. No difference. Only difference is in the awareness, level of awareness. We are not aware of ourselves. We are not aware of even the inner cover that we have, mind and senses. Master is constantly 24/7 aware of it. When masters come as human beings in a human life with karma, with just like a pattern like ours, their interaction with us is at the human level. And that is why masters, when they come here, don't pretend to be anybody higher than that. No perfect living master has even ever claimed to be a master. Great master never said he is a master. Guru Nanak has never said he was a guru. He said he was Dasan Das, the servant of the servants. If you see, no perfect living master said this. What they want to be, our friends, we become friends. And you can't be friends if you're not ordinary. If you're extraordinary, you can't have friendship. You have to be ordinary. And sometimes I give example, supposing an extraordinary master happens to come in here to see what's going on. And the extraordinariness is he can levitate. He's coming flying in the air like this. When he's flying overhead, he'll make some noise so we can see him. Otherwise, no use is coming. So when he gives a signal, all of you will look up and see a person flying over there. Wow, wonderful. Then what will be our thoughts? We look at that person. There must be some string attached. There is some trickery going on. That's the first thought. Second thought, maybe by some yogic practice, this man has learned real levitation and he's a real master. He's gone up there. You can have that feeling. Some may even faint seeing this, a body just moving around like that, ghostly figure. Some may not be sure if it's a real person. Many of us may worship him. He's really enlightened. Let's worship him. Extraordinary person. But none of us will be his friend, nor can we fall in love with that master. Supposing while he's performing his levitation and it falls down here, everybody sitting around will go and try to say, can we help you? First time, little compassion will come in your mind. Love and compassion does not flow just like that. Love and compassion flows for somebody who is like yourself, just like yourself. The more like yourself, more love and compassion flow. That is why these perfect living masters are giving us an example of love. And they come exactly like ordinary beings. So when they come as ordinary beings, then like ordinary beings, they say, okay, we have to now pick up some people. Where are they? They don't use magic for that. They carry list A, these souls we have to take. Where are they? They locate them, appear in their life by coincidences and circumstances, and then they become their friends and take them back gradually through the process of love. And we feel love and devotion in our hearts. We go and follow them and they take us inside and all above. So this is something that they remain ordinary. Therefore, in an ordinary sense, they say, okay, I have come for these people, not for the general public. Teachers come for big audiences. Perfect living masters come for the marked souls. Marked souls who are in their list which they have to carry back. As it happens, because of their awareness, they have an impact even on those who are not on the list that they are carrying. So that is why this phrase I have coined up, there is a list A for which they have come, a list B which they generate by being amongst other people who are not their marked sheep. So that is why masters come only for marked sheep. And this world is based on time and space. A human being can't be everywhere, and a human being can't be teaching everywhere. Therefore, they are born in different places where the seekers. They come where seeking is going on from the soul. And when they appear, they pick up the seekers for whom they have come. Therefore, they can't pick up everybody. There are millions of seekers on this planet. Millions. Masters will come time to time in different places where the seekers are. Sometimes there's an area with many seekers. And master is one human being. Then two masters will appear in the same area. With different sheets marked. One, these souls marked for one, these souls for another. A soul marked for one master happens to be in the presence of the other master, will not feel that pull. The other one, first master is pulling love, second perfect living master is not pulling. Why? Not his or her master. So therefore, this is not a generalized teaching that they come for. They come for individuals, and an individual can say, I found a perfect living master, you come to him, we're telling a friend. Friend says, I don't feel any pull. It's not necessary that the master is that friend's master also. There could be another master for the friend. So that is why as populations grow, the age changes from Satyug to Kaliyug, from the Iron Age to the Golden Age. Population size increases a lot before we destroy ourselves to enter the Golden Age. At that time, more masters come. In the beginning, very few masters exist, very few seekers are there. But in the age of Kali Yuga, in which we are passing now, more masters appear. More masters, there can be masters by thousands teaching us basic principles of going within. They are just teaching, go within, go within. They don't know what else is within. But they know there is something, they teach us. So we go to a master, he teaches us, go within. We say, Master, what next? We don't know. Next master will tell you. Second master comes to life, third comes to life, fourth comes to life. When our seeking goes on unsatisfied, the final perfect living master appears in our life and takes us back home. Till that journey, you may come across so many masters, including some perfect living masters who are not your master. So it's not a general game that the masters come for humanity and they've come to teach everybody to go. No, they are not teachers. So they come like that. So that is why you have to have your own master. One can say, my master, great master, when I was with him, I felt he was only my master. How could a person love you so much that you can feel he could be loving somebody else? We are not used to that as human beings. We like to be very unique, and uniqueness means separation. Masters are here to remove separation, and we want separation to become exclusive. Master, you should only love me. Be exclusive. Let other people find their own masters. That's how mind runs. And very often, the intensity of a master's love gives us that feeling. He's only our master. Others are only in the early stages, they find their own masters. It happens because these thoughts come from our mind, which divide, exclude, separate. And master's love is for union, for uniting. That is why the love is strong, but masters can make you feel they're only exclusive master. And they can give you that feeling, which is great. Their love is so powerful. They don't have to think whether I love a person or not. It's automatic. Almost radiates from them. When you are in the presence, something is affecting us without even knowing how it's affecting. So that is why these masters affect us. When people ask me, which master should I follow? Generally, this question is coming from their mind. Tell me the master, I'll check him out. I'll see if he's a master or not. If we human beings can find out who is a master or not, we are masters ourselves. We can't find. And masters can play games so that a person who's only curious to check him out, they'll pretend they are completely non-masters. He says, yes, I found out, he's not a master. A master can do that because that person is not on their list. His list B. So it's a very complicated game. Now, I can't tell you exactly how master perform, but one day I think I'll check into the master's manual of operation and see what else they can tell us. But it is a very wonderful thing I tell people, follow the master who pulls you. There was a master in India, in a dera, I'm giving a name, he's passed away. His name was Baba Pratap Singh. And he had a dera in a place very, very close, about 20 miles away from the dera where great master was there. The dera that was where great master worked was called Dera Baba Jamal Singh, named after his master, Jamal Singh. The other dera was called Dera Baba Bagga Singh because another disciple, Swamiji, was setting that up. So there were two deras there. They were pretty close to each other. They are both owing allegiance to the teachings of one master, Seth Dayal Singh Swamiji of Agra, who set up the Radha Swami faith. This Dava Pratap Singh was initiated by the successor of Baba Bhaga Singh. Baba Bhaga Singh's successor name was Deva Singh. Very interesting story. When great master was alive, my father and I were also his disciples. One day, my father was standing next to great master while he was talking to a group of sevadars. And a message came, somebody brought a little message. Message said that Bhaga Singh has died of the other Dera and people are not sure who is the successor. You please come and decide. So, great master Baba Savan Singh turned to my father and said, Lekhraj, that was his name, Lekhraj, do you have your car here? And he said, yes, it's parked right there. He said, we have to go to Tarun Taran right now. Baba Bhaga Singh has passed away and they are not sure who their successor is. So my dad took the great master in his car to Tarun Taran. Their great master gave a discourse, a satsang, and said, Deva Singh will be the next master. Because of the nature of his personality, what great master would speak, most people would accept. So the disciples of Baba Bhaga Singh accepted the choice. So Baba Deva Singh became the master. Then Baba Deva Singh had a disciple named Pratap Singh, who was a wrestler. He was a good wrestler. He could wrestle with people. He was a disciple. So he got initiated from Baba Deva Singh. But he, because of this close relationship, because great master had gone to their Dera, many of the followers of Deva Singh would also attend satsangs, attend discourses in the great master Dera, Baba Jamal Singh Dera. So Pratap Singh would come there, and when he would see great master, he was pulled by love. When he would go back to listen to his own master, there was no pull. He was surprised. He did meditation, and part of the meditation is called dhyan, contemplation of the face of your master. When he would contemplate, instead of his master Deva Singh appearing, Baba Savan Singh would appear. And he would try to push Savan Singh aside in meditation to try to imagine his own master. It became difficult. So, this Pratap Singh went to great master Baba Savan Singh. And he said, why are you messing up my meditation? I am not your disciple. I am disciple of Baba Deva Singh, who you appointed there. And I am trying to do his dhyan, I am trying to remember him, as you are coming in my meditation and interfering. Great master laughed and said, Pratap Singh, when any disciple of a master has a problem in meditation, he should go to his own master. Why have you come to me? You have a problem in meditation, go to your master. So Pratap Singh went back and went to his master, Baba Deva Singh, and said, Master, I am your initiate. And when I try to meditate, I can't remember you. I remember Baba Savan Singh. And I went to him and I told him, why are you interfering in my meditation? And he said, if you have a problem in meditation, go to your own master. So I've come to you. And Baba Deva Singh said, Pratap Singh, all masters in their highest form are the same. It's the same master power which is just manifesting in different human bodies. It does not mean that the power is different. It does not mean any difference at all. Which route you take, when you go into the same place, and therefore, it doesn't matter whether that master is your master or I am your master. The one that pulls you is the one that you love. Your love has developed for Baba Savan Singh and not for me. Therefore, Now I am advising you, go back to Baba Sawan Singh and tell him this and ask him, Baba Sawan Singh, do you accept me as your disciple? So Baba Pratap Singh did that, went back and told Great Master, this is what my conversation is with my master. He has sent me now this time. Will you accept me as your disciple? And Great Master smiled and said, Beshak, of course. And so he began to meditate on Baba Pratap Singh. Pratap Singh began to meditate on Baba Sawan Singh. This is a very important feature that we sometimes feel, oh, I don't know who is my master. When people ask me, any master who pulls you is your master at that time. He may not even be a perfect master. But you are at the stage in your spiritual journey, you need that master. Follow the master that pulls you with his love. And if that is not your master, you will yourself find out that you are not satisfied. The seeking will continue. Another master will appear in your life to take you forward. When you are ready to go to your true home, your seeking will be only for your true home. A perfect living master will appear in your life. So that is why one should not worry too much about wherever the pole is, go there. One friend of mine wrote to me, tell me truthfully, these two masters, which one should I follow? Who is higher? I said to him, I am no judge of masters. I am not a master myself. I am trying to be sevadar of my master, trying to serve him. But all I can say is that whichever master pulls you, go follow. He wrote back to me, both of them are pulling me. Now tell me which one I follow. I said, people can't find even one perfect master. How lucky you are to find two. Follow any one of those two. They're equally good. So these things happen in life. And we get into situations, the mind asks questions, mind wants to be satisfied. Another issue comes up. A strange feeling is, they think that getting initiated by a master is like being married to the master. Oh, I am his disciple. Am I betraying my master by going somewhere else? So many people used to say this to Great Master said, you can go anywhere. He not only allowed, he asked his people, go anywhere, any master, if something is better than I can give you, take it. And come and tell me, he said, I will also take it. They are so open. And we in our mind say, maybe I am not being loyal to the master. It's not a game of loyalty here. It's a game of going within yourself and finding who the master is. Even to know if you are initiated or not, go inside and find out. So the whole journey is inside to discovery. And we are playing the same games outside like we play with normal families and normal relationships. That's not the relationship with a master. Master works like an ordinary person. You're not married to the master. You are being pulled by the master to go back home and leave all marriages around here. Leave everything here which has not worked well. I would still like to meet a few couples who can say after some years, our marriage is very successful. I haven't found them yet. But I hear stories otherwise all the time of broken relationships, too much expectations. That is why it's not a relationship like that. These worldly relationships are all tied up with our payment of our past karma. It's not something that we have really found our beloved and we found somebody. These are all relationships created from karma and we have to pay off our price, which we are doing. Whether you do it more cheerfully, you can pay off your karma very nicely if you know it's a payoff and you have to pay your bills. When we have to pay the bills that we buy things, we pay cheerfully. We got something, we're giving. Karma is like that. We get good karma, we get bad karma. We are all happy good karma is okay. So why is bad karma being imposed on us? Nobody imposed it. It's our own doing. We're just paying for it. And I always say, the Marriage is one of the fastest ways to pay off karma. It's true. It creates the conditions where you're so close to each other. When you're dating, it's a different situation. When you're married, it's a different situation. I had, in the 60s, I had a friend named Emily. And Emily was married to Ross. They both lived in Nevada. When they fell in love, it was such a deep love, they said it is a, we are what they call pairs.
Soulmates.
Soulmates pair. We are soulmates pair. We are made for each other. Our marriage is really made in heaven, others are only spoken as heaven. And after a few years, they were in divorce court. They divorced. They suddenly discovered they're not made for each other at all. They were completely different in their thinking. Now looks the real story. When they separated, they loved each other again. First they said, oh, we are divorced, but we are like friends. Then the friendship grew into love, and they were soulmates again. And they got married again. Second marriage, same pair. After 2 years, fights began, arguments began, divorce again. After 1 year of divorce, they were in love again, each other. That couple married and divorced 3 times. And when I studied their life, what was happening, the experiences they have when they were not married and felt they were a couple together were so much different than the experience they had after getting married. So I was thinking, why should that be just an institution? Some people say just a paper. But a paper can do so much havoc to your personal life. I didn't know that. I told somebody how a little paper, which is called a marriage certificate, little paper can create so many problems for a person, which they never seen before. Living happily and suddenly, now they have to please others, which you can never please. A young man went to his father, dad. He said, Dad, I want to get married. He said, say sorry. He said, why sorry? I just say I want to get married. Say sorry. But tell me what's my fault. Say sorry. But there must be some reason for it. No, say sorry. Okay, I say sorry. Now you're qualified to get married. You have to be ready to say sorry even if you don't know why you are saying sorry. Then you're fit for marriage. It's a very interesting how these things happen. So, don't worry, this is not a marriage. It's a true love. Marriage generates experiences of payoff of karma. True love of a master cuts out the karma, does not create more karma. One more last question.
How does the decision, karma, of a national leader affect the destiny of the nation, the people of the nation, war, partition, migration, etc.?
How do we make decisions? We make decisions with free will. And we have built in our ideas about what is good, what is bad. This is a division made by the mind, which establishes a moral code of good and evil, so that we can use free will for doing good things or bad things. As it happens, the moral code that we use is created by our experience here. Wherever we are born, the parents, the school, the friends, siblings, peers, all those affect us and teach us what the moral code is. So we grow up with that moral code. A moral code becomes as if it is a code written by God Himself. Moral code changes from country to country, culture to culture, age to age. It's kept on changing. That is why you cannot say there's an absolute moral code at all. But in terms of relative moral code, there are. We know to kill somebody is murder. But if you kill your enemy, it's an honorable thing. Same act. There are so many acts that we are making them dignified, which would ordinarily fall into the other category. When we go through life, our karma is based upon our understanding of this moral code, which registers inside the mind, in a corner of the mind. And that corner of the mind where it registers, we call conscience. Not conscious, conscience. Conscience is constantly speaking into our head, telling us what is good, what is bad, all built up on our upbringing and so on. So that is why when we make certain decisions, it is not possible always to justify by some other moral standards, but it's only justified by the moral standard where you are there. As it happens, the moral standards laid down by some culture at some time and in recorded version comes down heavily, and the parents of a child are inculcating those moral values in the child. It's very hard to live with that moral code. Moral code was set up very high standards, and mind doesn't want that standard. So what happens is that when we want to live that moral code, we do not follow it. And we are constantly committing what we call sin. We are constantly committing sin, wrong decisions we are taking because we are not following that moral code. When children come, we teach them the moral code that is standard, and they watch us betraying that moral code. Children learn from what they are watching, not from what we are preaching. We preach them the moral code, the standard moral code, and yet they are working on what they are seeing their parents do, and their uncles are doing, what others are doing. So their experience becomes like rebelling against their own parents, their own, and so the problem gets even worse. So generation after generation, this is happening. And when I was talking to you about carrying guilt, the guilt is being carried because the moral standards which were laid down way back by some are being tried to be enforced. We can't follow it, and we feel that we are carrying guilt with us. So it's not really necessary. So these national leaders and all, those who have to work, there are so many leaders who are working and have to give orders in war. They think they're doing the right thing. Imagine the terrorism going on. If you ask a terrorist, why are you doing this bad thing? He said, what bad thing? I am doing the right thing. My boss told me, if I kill so many people, I'll get a much better place in heaven. All the same moral code sitting from that religion, from the old text that has been brought up. So that is why the national leaders who affect us even more, they are following something which is very different from what we believe in. So that is why there's rebellion, societal changes take place because of that, and a lot of other things. The only good thing is that no matter what is going on around you, no matter what your karma is, so long as you are seeking the truth inside, you're seeking the ultimate truth, in the worst of circumstances, a master will appear. Masters are known to have appeared in the prison of people who are committed in prison for something heinous they have done, and masters have appeared there. Masters have taken care of people whom we would reject as criminals, and they've taken them up. Great master himself had one person appearing in his life who was a robber, gangster, and he belonged to a gang. They're committing these evil things of killing people. And since the gang was also interested in looting property, thefts, they found out that the dera in which great master was working was having a building set up, and top of the building there'll be gold lining on the minarets on top. So people were willing to donate cash and jewelry. Women took off their gold jewelry so it can be used on that building. It was all being stored in different places. So much jewelry was brought in by all the disciples because it seemed to be used on the top of the building there. Big sentiment about it. This gang heard that they have a lot of gold sitting there. Doesn't seem to be a very well guarded place. So that's a good place to go commit robbery. They sent one man to go and do reconnaissance where the gold is kept. Then we will go in our truck and loot all that gold and bring it. So this man, whose name was Shadi, they called him Shadi. By the way, Shadi means marriage, okay. This man came to the dera and at a time when great master was giving a discourse. So he knew everybody will be there, so he'll go and check where the gold is. And he found a house in which there were children playing. He said, "Children, what are you doing here?" "Oh, my mom said, don't move from here because we have stored the gold here." He said, "Where is stored?" "In that basket there." He said, "I have never found an easy target like this." He went to another place. Some women were there in that another house. "Why haven't you gone to listen to the satsang? Great master is giving a discourse." "No, we are staying here taking care of the gold." "Where is the gold?" "It's locked up there. We don't touch it." "Wow, so easy." A thought came to this man. What kind of master is he? That when he teaches something, people don't bother about their gold. They don't bother about their wealth just to go and listen to him. They left this wealth in the hands of the children and old ladies here. What kind of master is he? What does he teach? This thought came. And as the thought came, he said, "I'll go and check what's happening." A small crowd of people were sitting. So he went and stood at the back. When he sat there, great master was giving a discourse and he's praising the power of initiation, the power of the word that comes through us, flows and pulls us all the way up. He says, "That power, that naam, is in everybody, including gangsters and thieves." Man got shaken up. How does he know I am here? So he waited for the discourse to be over and he went straight to the master before master could get up. "How do you know I am a robber?" He says, "Oh, I don't know you. Who are you?" He says, "No, you know me. You pointed at me, you looked at me and said even robbers and gangsters have that." He said, "That's nothing big thing. I say it every day. It was not meant for you." "No, no, I know that you are trying to now back up. I know you found me. How did you know I am this?" To cut a long story short, he applied for initiation, did not go back to his gang, and master accepted him. Not only accepted him, he was virtually his traveling companion and guard. Traveled everywhere with the great master went, that Shadi, and did so much meditation. The whole passion he had for robbery, he transferred into meditation. Great master said, "You have to do some work, because this is not a freebie living in the dera." He said, "But I never learned to work." He says, "Even when you go to rob people, you must be learning something." He says, "Yes, we go in the truck, and I am the expert on the electrical side. If our dynamo breaks up, then I know how to rewire it and put it back in there. Gray said, good, do that work here. So for the first time, a generator was put up, installed in the dera, and it was an old type of generator where there was a big leather strap, and we had to pull the leather strap to start it, to start the engine, and then it would just like this go, tuck, 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 and keep working and produce some power. So the first line he drew of power in Great Master's house, so first time we saw a lamp there, lighted up. So I remember this because I used to sometimes go and pull the leather belt of it and became good friends. Now this man had such wonderful experiences in life. Totally turned. Great Master accepted that robber with as much affection and love as except anybody else. So masters operate on a very different level. But people have to go through their life. Nations are led by leaders, and leaders lead to these kinds of activities in their belief they're doing the right thing. In the belief that's what the best. Two leaders can think completely different values, but whoever is in power uses the value of his moral code, not the others. Thank you very much for spending time with me. We'll meet next month again.